Which is better, one or two? One or two?
Two!
One or two? When I was a kid, like 4 or 5 or 6 years old, I lived in a small apartment that was dominated by three big things. There was a TV set, there was a couch, and there was my mom. At least my mom seemed big. She towered over me, even though she was only 4 feet, 10 and a half inches tall. She had this red curly hair and a stern expression on her face, because she worked all the time. But on weekends, she got to kick back in her bunny slippers and do crossword puzzles. My dad, on the other hand, he was this happy-go-lucky fellow with these dark sunglasses that kind of matched his dark hair. and this dark turtleneck sweater that he always wore, kind of like he was in Simon and Garfunkel. I don't know which one he was supposed to be. And then he had this kind of Mr. Rogers footwear sensibility. And then there was me. Morgan. And I'm kind of sad and bummed out sometimes because my parents are separated. But for my fourth or fifth or sixth birthday one year, my mom, she threw me this big party. It was the best. There was ice cream and there was party hats and there was a piñata. And my dad was visiting and he brought me this guitar for a present. Before he left, he taught me a few simple chords. I think I still remember them. So which is better? One or two? Mom, even at 4 or 5 or 6 years old, you learn to be really self-sufficient. Every morning I was up at the crack of dawn, I would make my own breakfast and get myself dressed. Underpants first, and then I like to put on my long sleeve shirt so that you can see the sleeves after I put the short sleeve shirt on. And then I would save the pants for last. Oh, but let me tell you about this couch. This couch is one of those hide-a-bed style sofas, and it's upholstered with this really fine, irregular black and white stripe pattern, like someone went out and shot and killed a whole herd of little tiny zebras, and then covered the couch with their hides. On Saturday mornings when I get up at 6 a.m., I like to go in the living room and I lie on the back of the couch. And there's all this sunlight streaming in through the bay window, and I close my eyes, and I see these explosions of red and orange and yellow. And then I slide down the front of the couch until my head comes onto the ground. I love the way the apartment looks upside down, and I like to pretend that I'm walking on the ceiling. I get to the door jamb, and I have to do a little jump. I keep going. I make my way to one of the ceiling fixtures, and I sit down beside it and warm my hands in the glow of the light bulb, like I'm at a campfire. All right, now the pants. Which is better, one or two?
Two!
And then at 6:30 on a Saturday morning, the moment I've been waiting for all week, it's the moment when the first cartoon comes on TV. And this is a show called Mr. Magoo! I don't know if you know this show, Mr. Magoo, but it's about a little old white guy. His name is Mr. Magoo. Maybe he's Irish-American or something. And he sort of sounds like the millionaire from Gilligan's Island. He talks like, hello, I'm Mr. Magoo. How do you do? But the thing that makes him special, the whole premise of the show, is that Mr. Magoo can't really see. It's not like he's completely blind or anything with the whole like dark glasses and white cane bit. It's just that whenever he sees one thing, he thinks that it's something else. Like, for example, he would see this, and he would say, oh, Charlie, what have they done with you? They've cryogenically frozen you in this great big block of ice. I'll just get out my welding equipment and thaw you out. But we all know that this isn't a piece of welding equipment. It's a guitar. And we all know that this is not Charlie, the racial stereotyped sidekick, cryogenically frozen in a block of ice. It is a couch. And even at 4 or 5 or 6 years old, I know that Mr. Magoo is not a very funny show. The joke of him not being able to see isn't funny the first time it happens. It's not funny time after time, every single Saturday of the year, every year of my entire life. But it's 6:30 on a Saturday morning. It's the only cartoon on TV. And so I watch it. You know, it is funny. What's funny is that every week when I'm watching this show about a guy who can't really see, I have to inch myself closer and closer and closer to the TV set in order to be able to see it. My mom, she doesn't think this is funny. She comes in and she says, "Margaret, why are you sitting so close to the TV?" And I say, "Mom, I can't see." And Mr. Magoo says, "Oh, Charlie, what are we doing in Timbuktu?" And my mom's face says a lot. Because what I don't know, the whole reason that my dad wears those dark sunglasses all the time is because he's legally blind. Yeah, with like the dark glasses and the white cane and that whole bit. He's just really nearsighted, just like Mr. Magoo. And he's incredibly photophobic, which means he's sensitive to light. And what nobody knows at 4 or 5 or 6 years old is whether or not I have that coin flip of 50% chance to have inherited the same eye disease that he has. So my mom takes me, and we go into the car. And I always wear my seatbelt, of course. And as we drive, what we love to do is we like to listen to the radio, and I like to sing along to all the songs, Top 40 radio. And I know a lot of the songs, even the older ones. Oh, like that one by Bruce Springsteen that goes, "Blinded by the light, revved up like a deuce, another runner in the night." But my mom doesn't seem to like that song at the moment. So she changes the station, and then, oh, it's the classic rock station. They're playing that glam rock band Kiss, and they go, "Yeah, I think I'm going blind." And then my mom doesn't like Kiss. I mean, they're kind of bad. And then, oh, yeah, and then it's that cool old school hip hop duo, Run DMC, going, "You're blind. You can't see, you need to wear some glasses like DMC, you're blind." And my mom doesn't like, "Mom, why don't you like rap music? It's so cool." Oh, but then there's Morrissey. "Yes, I'm blind. No, I can't see. The good things, just the bad things. Oh, oh, it's me." My mom, she doesn't really dig Morrissey too much. I mean, I think he's all the best. Oh, and then we finally settle on something. You know, they're playing my entire album side of my favorite rock opera, Tommy by The Who. "That deaf, dumb, and blind kid sure plays mean pinball." And then we arrive at some building, and my mom takes me into the elevator, and we go all the way up, 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 up to the top floor, where I meet a man who just might change my life.
"Greetings, it is I, Dr. Macula, pediatric optometrist. Please have a seat 20 feet away from my eye chart and cover one eye. Please, everybody, cover one eye. And have a look at what you see on the top line. On line number one, who can tell me what it is?"
"E."
"Wonderful. How about line number two?"
"Okay."
"Okay, and respond very promptly to what you see on line number three."
"RSVP."
"Okay, and now we all need to concentrate together. And what is written on line number four?" "No, you are not in the elevator. You're in Dr. Macula's office." "Okay. Well, what does this mean? If you could see clearly what was written on line number four, and that was many of you, congratulations, you have the 20/20 vision. But if you could not see it so well, and you could only see line number three, or two, or one, then you have the 20/50, or the 20/100, or the 20/200 vision!" "In which case, we have another special test for you. Okay, go ahead and cover one eye and tell me, Which is better when you look through the lens, one or two?
One?
How about now, one or two?
Two?
And what about now, one or two?
Dr. Macula, look, I'm only 4 or 5 or 6 years old and everything just kind of looks the same and sort of blurryish.
It is exactly as I suspected. You, young man, need glasses. And I think I'm here someplace. I have a pair that will fit you. Let me see. Okay. Yes. Okay, go ahead and try these on. And then come back and see me next year. And then he was gone. And this, I don't really think that this is what I needed. You know, what I actually needed was some advice. Advice on how to be a vampire. Because even at 4 or 5 or 6 years old, I thought I knew everything that there was to know about being a vampire. You know, they told me about the constant thirst for blood, the strong allergy to garlic, the photophobia. And, you know, that problem with the church, I don't know, Catholic or Lutheran or something like that, I don't know, something about the, I don't know, whatever. But what they didn't tell me about being a vampire is that the whole thing that's the key to the vampiric identity is passing. You know, when you don't want anyone to know that you're one thing and you try to pass for being something else. Because when everybody knows that you're a vampire, your whole life is going to change, or your whole afterlife or whatever is going to change. You know, your neighbors are going to avoid you like the plague. Your friend, the one with the van that's always helping you move stuff, you're going to be like, hey, help me move this box. And he's going to be like, no, man, that is a coffin full of dirt. I know exactly what you're trying to do, and I don't think we can be friends anymore. Work, that becomes a little tricky, too. Your boss is like, where are you? Come in here. Get into my office. All right, come on and have a seat on my lap. I know you've been with us for a long time, and I hate to do this to you, but take that right in the heart, you things, face, blood sucker! Sorry to let you go. And then there are relationships. Whew. Yeah. Because, let me tell you, whenever you're going to be intimate with someone, whenever you first meet them and start to get to know them, you want to be upfront and honest with them, right? You want to tell them all your deepest, darkest secrets. But if you say, hey, baby, I'm a vampire, and they don't go running, screaming in bloody terror, and they do seem to like you, they might not like you for you. They just like the idea of you being a vampire. They sort of tokenize you a little bit. They're like, yeah, I have this friend. Oh, he's a vampire. Oh, yeah, some of my best friends are vampires. Well, I dated a vampire once. Really? How was it? Oh, it was spooky. You want to see the fang marks? I still have scars. But let's suppose you're going on a date. And maybe it's like just a lunch date, just a casual, you know, getting together for coffee or donuts or whatever. And then maybe it's a date. You know, whatever the case, you're doing your best. You invited a bunch of friends over to help you pick out your clothes. And you want to do the whole, you know, you want to fix your hair, do something with your hair, but that whole mirror thing, that's not working out. So, you know, you want to be late for your appointment, so you go and you find public transportation and you take it to the other side of the stage. And you emerge and you come to the restaurant and everything's so brightly lit, you know. There's this big plate glass window and all the sunlight streaming in. And you can't see, you can't make out anyone. You know, everyone just kind of is sort of blurryish. And you see a hand go up across the restaurant, waving in your direction. And you go and you follow the hand. But it's someone just flagging down the waiter for their check. And then you see someone else flagging down the waiter for their check. And you just ignore them. But then that is your date. And your date comes over and says, hey, I'm over here. Didn't you see me? I got us a table by the window. You can't sit by the window. You're a vampire. You'll disintegrate in all that sunlight. But what are you supposed to say?
can we just go be in that dark, gloomy corner over there? You see, I'm extremely photophobic. It's a hereditary condition. So if you were thinking of having kids with me, maybe we should just get the check now and go our separate ways. No, that's not happening.
So you sit down by the window, and you get out the menu, and you look at it. And it's in this font, and it's just like all the sunlight streaming in, and your date leans in real close and says, "Do you need glasses?" No, I have them, but they're in my pants, you know. And the waiter comes over, and your date knows exactly what to order. Yes. I'll have the steak. I'll have it well done with a side of garlic mashed potatoes, and to drink, a Bloody Mary. Me, I'm just looking. I have some dietary issues. Is it possible to get the pesto pasta without the garlic?
No.
What about the hummus plate? Your date tries to be helpful and says, "You should really try the steak. The steak, the way that they make it, they sear it over an open flame and it has a nice sharp flavor. It really gets to the point." And the waiter's like, "Oh yes, sir, the steak is our most popular item." And the people at the next table are eavesdropping and they're like, steak. And you're like, "Well, I'm just not really feeling like the steak right now. I don't really want the steak." And your date's like, "Oh, the steak with all the juice dripping down, it's so luscious." And the waiter's like, "Oh yes, sir, the steak is really wonderful." And the people at the next table jump up and they start chanting, "Steak! Steak! 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 Steak!" I am just not feeling the steak right now. In fact, I don't even want to be here when your steak arrives with those stinky ass garlic mashed potatoes. And I want to just, what I want to do is turn into a bat and spread my wings and fly out of this brightly lit place. And then I ask you, "Do you want to come with me?" And you say, "Yeah, I do." And we fly super duper high out of the restaurant and out of the city and way up into the clouds. Up into the stratosphere where it gets super dark and gloomy, and we leave, we go past the suburbs and the exurbs, and then we're in the mountains where there's my dark, gloomy castle. Yeah, the dark, gloomy castle. There's the dark, gloomy castle. Yeah, and then we land in the belfry, and we just hang out. You know, upside down. And your date leans in real close and says,
"So, do you always wear a cape and no pants?"
And you take your date by the hand and you say, "Would you like to dance?"
Yeah.
Which is better, one or two?
Two.
Jimmy,
Bobby,
Kevin,
Kareem,
Tyson,
Susan,
Hector Menendez,
Hector Gonzalez,
Alicia, Alicia, Anissa, Anisha, Alana, Ayana, Becca.
Jill.
Jaime.
Kupampazua.
Morgan. All right, who's ready to play some wiffle ball? Let me hear you say yeah!
Yeah!
This is how the game works. The way the game works is I'm gonna hit the ball. And you gotta have your catcher's mask on. If you didn't bring your catcher's mask today, you better put your hands up in front of your face so you can still see, but you're protected from the ball. Maybe you wanna do a little duck and cover your knees into your chest or something like that. So when I tap the home plate, it means that I'm ready to swing, okay? Everyone got their catcher's mask on? Because I'm really gonna hit this ball. Right past the shortstop, in between the shortstop and the second baseman, right past the pitcher's mound. All right, here we go, you ready? All right, here we go. Ready? The ball. We're all on the same team, right?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So you're gonna tell me when to swing. Okay?
Good.
All right. Pitcher number one, are you ready?
Yep.
Okay.
Swing!
See right one! All right, everybody. We got this. We got this. We can do it. Okay. All right. Pitcher number two, are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay. Team is really counting on me. You know, every time I get picked last in baseball, my team always loses. And we can't let that happen. So I'm really counting on all of you to help me hit the ball. Okay. Got it? All right, pitcher number three. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
Swing!
Swing! Strike three. You're out of here.
Oh.
Not fair. Why do we have to play stupid baseball every year? Why do I have to play it? They all know I can't see so good. It's just so humiliating. Everybody hates me. So my science report is in three parts, and the first part is the oral component. It's called
12 different ways that I've lost, broken, or ruined my glasses. Number one, playing with the stems. Number two, swimming in the ocean. Number three, soccer practice. Number four, playing with a can of spray paint on a windy day. Number five, the time I left them on the cafeteria tray. Number six, loose screw. Number seven, riding on a roller coaster. Oh, number eight, my favorite tool in shop class, the spin sander. Number nine, 10, and 11, skateboarding, sledding, and breakdancing. And number 12, the time I gave them to Bob. But why do I have to wear glasses anyway, huh? And why do us kids who wear glasses have to go back to the stupid eye doctor every year and get a new pair? Yeah, and why do 3 out of 4 Americans who are adults end up wearing glasses when that number was only half that just 50 years ago, huh? Well, that brings me to the visual component of my report. The human eye and how it works. This is your eye. It's shaped like a ball. And this is the front of your eye where your eyelashes are, and maybe you have some eyebrows and your top of your head, and maybe you have some hair up there. And then down here is the bottom of your face. And you're looking great. Now, in the front of your eye, there's a natural built-in lens. And the lens's job is to focus whatever it is that you see out there and then transmit it up to your brain in the top of your skull. So what you see is what you know. But a lot of us, instead of having an eye that's shaped like, you know, like a baseball, our eye is shaped like a football. And then the focus doesn't really focus where it's supposed to happen, so things are just kind of muddled up top there. And so this is when my mom takes me to the eye doctor, and the eye doctor puts an artificial lens in front of my natural built-in lens, and that lens is called glasses. But what happens is, over the course of the year, my eyes adjust to this thing that got put in front of my body. And so I go back the next year, and I need a stronger prescription. And I go back the next year, and I need a stronger prescription. And a stronger prescription. And by then, I'm in junior high, and I've got problems with acne on my face. And I need a stronger prescription. And my dad's not around, so I don't know how to shave. And I've got stubble, and I get a stronger prescription. And then I'm in high school, and I have like an Ankh earring. I got it pierced. And then I get a stronger prescription. And then, you know, sometime I'm in high school, and I grow like a boogie beard. And then in my early 20s, maybe I get a facial tattoo that's like satanic or something. And then I get a stronger prescription. And then I'm so old that I become someone's dad and I never learn to shave and I have this big handlebar mustache which covers up the tattoo. And this is what I look like. So, this brings me to the kinesthetic portion of my report because I failed gym class. An interpretive dance that expresses how I feel about this whole situation. Hit it!
Thank you.
Dr. Macula. I used to be a pediatric optometrist, but I've since been promoted, and now I am an ophthalmologist. Come on over here and have a look at this diagram. As you can see, every year I've been prescribing you a stronger and stronger prescription to accommodate for the faulty lens at the front of your eye. But it turns out that this was never the problem at all. No, the problem was in the back of your eye, in the retina. Let me explain this to you. Your retina in the back of your eye has two primary types of cells. On the periphery, where it is dark, exist a long, skinny cell shaped like a rod. These are called the rods. Aren't they beautiful? And they control your black and white vision, your darkness, night vision, your most primitive, most animalistic vision. But in the periphery, in the light, in the center of the eye, there exists another type of cell called the cone. And the problem is that your cones, they are degenerate. Look at this one. He is smoking a cigarette. And this one here, he is cheating at dice. And this one over here, he is cheating at cards, doing a little three-cone Monty right there. This one up here is cheating on his girlfriend, yes. In fact, he has two girlfriends, yes. And they do not know about each other. It is very evil. Oh, and this one here, he's playing hooky from school and spending the entire day going around and around and around on a Ferris wheel, doing nothing with his life. And all of these cones in the center of your eye, they control the day system, the color system, your primary central vision, and they live on what is like a little island, a coney island. Yes, it's very, very bad. So, the good news is, I, Dr. Macula, have discovered what is wrong with you. Yes, it is very rare disease. The bad news is, there is no cure. I don't know how to treat this disease, it is so rare. But what I can give you is this special card that tells you that you are legally blind! I'm blind! But I can see. I mean, mostly I can see. In some situations, I can't see. And what I end up doing is passing for one or the other, either passing for sighted to avoid the stigma of being called blind or these assumptions about me that aren't true, or sometimes I pass for being blinder than I actually am in order to get services. Because these doctors, they can't help me. So I have to turn to other institutions, like the United States government. So I take the public transportation to the other side of the stage. And I come to this big building. And on it says, services for the blind and visually impaired. I go inside, I show them my ID. I make my way down the hall. Oh, and there are all these framed pictures of famous blind people from history. There's Helen Keller, Louis Braille. I didn't know he was blind. And oh, some authors. There's Aldous Huxley and Jorge Luis Borges. And oh, the musicians, like Blind Blake, Blind Levin Jefferson, Blind Willie McTell, Blind Willie Johnson, the five blind boys of Alabama, the seven blind boys of Mississippi, Ray Charles, Little Stevie Wonder, and Moondog. Yeah, yeah. And then I go to the elevator and I take it up to the top floor and the doors open and there is a man that might change my life.
At long last, you have come. Oh, ye who walks with one leg in the land of the sighted and stands with one in the realm of the blind, I know your kind. You don't know where you've been and you can't see where you're going. Because you are not willing to accept your identity and take responsibility for your destiny. But I have ways of helping you. Tools that might be useful in your quest. I speak, of course, of one of the most powerful objects in the known universe. Yes, I think you know what it might be. It is the Rod of Power! Power! Behold how it shines, its surface more reflective than that of the moon. It is strong yet lightweight, made of the finest graphite. And this rod possesses powers untold, powers of navigation. Let us suppose you are making your way about the town. You are vaguely aware that there are others around you, but are they aware of you? They bustle and jostle you to and fro, and you feel confused, not taken care of. Society has let you down. What are you going to do as the mob closes in closer and closer? You simply brandish your cane and strut in for us. The crowd parts before you, allowing you safe. Allowing you safe passage. So too does the rod have powers of manipulation. Now that everyone is out of your way, you have been wandering for long, and you grow tired, cold, hot, weary, hungry. All you want is for someone to give up their seat to you, and they do readily, Escapus! And they help you to sit down. Regale you with conversation. They give you handshakes and back rubs. And you are treated like a king among men. Yes, and so too does the rod have powers of visibility. For not only does it make the entire world more visible to you, it makes you visible to the world. For as you move through it, all shall know you and fear you and love you for what you really are. And you and your king shall become inseparable one. And it will become your most precious item. You will go nowhere without it, and it will mark you for your true identity. So are you willing to accept responsibility and meet your destiny? Huh?
Yeah.
I don't know that I am. Because while it's nice for, you know, to have like something that's like a magic wand that makes other people treat you kind of special or something, like we're all special. We should all be treating each other nice all the time and looking out for each other regardless of ability or disability. And also, I don't need this because I can see. I don't need this to get around. It would simply mark me as being a thing, and then people would make all these assumptions about me. And it carries a lot of stigma. In the future, I might not have that choice, but right now I do. So, lately I've been on this vision quest. Yeah, I've been doing all kinds of stuff to help my eyesight, my vision, whatever you want to call it. You know, I've taken up a vegan diet. I started practicing yoga. It's really actually helping. It's really, really great. And I've been doing these eye exercises. But the people who teach these things, they live like far away on mountaintops or, you know, on some remote island or something. They're really hard to get in touch with. So I mailed away for this package to just see what's inside of it. Oh, hang on. It's a tape recorder. Yeah, and inside the tape recorder, there's a tape. Let's see what's on it.
Greetings, and welcome to cassette number one of the Nazi for the Eyes.
I know that voice.
I am your personal trainer, Count Macula.
Count Macula?
Yes, I used to be Dr. Macula, but since becoming a new age healer, they have revoked my medical license. But do not worry, you can still count on me. The gymnasium for the eyes can be practiced along with your friends, so if there are others, please follow along. In the box, find one elastic band and one very important fan-shaped card. Hopefully everyone else has brought their own. We will use these things to channel the psychic energy, okay? Wonderful! Begin by curling the corners of the card inward until those two little holes overlap. Can you hold that together with one hand? We will need the other hand to thread the elastic band through the holes. Once you do that, we will put the other end of the elastic into the remaining hole and pull it tight. Then, voila! We have created a special shape to channel the psychic energy. It fits the shape to your head. Did you figure it out? Do you need an extra moment? It is time for our daily dose of Count Macula's magic potion. Please, find the bottle, pull the cork, and drink. Drink every drop, for Count Macula's magic potion contains a blend of natural medicines for the eyes, including the roots of dandelion, burdock, ginseng, astragalus, bloodwort, turmeric, and carrots. It also contains spirulina, milk thistle, calendula, wolf's bane, wormwood, actual worms, witch hazel, and bat urine. All still in a tincture of blueberries. Now we are ready to begin exercise number one, channeling the psychic energy. Hold your hands up in front of this special shape and rub them together. Everybody, please, hands up and rub. Palm against palm. Listen to the sound of all the wonderful hands and feel the friction. Now, close your eyes and imagine that the sound is the wind blowing through the treetops. As the wind blows harder, rub your hands faster to generate more heat. It sounds like a storm is coming. Now stop! Separate your hands just 1 inch. Can you feel the psychic energy? Like a little black rain cloud ready to burst. Oh, this rain cloud, it is growing bigger and bigger and floating up, 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 all the way, as high as your hands can reach. Feel how heavy that little black cloud is, full of psychic energy. On the count of three, we will take the rain cloud and pull it down to impale it on the point of this special shape. Are you ready? Here we go. 1, 2, 3. Oh, isn't it wonderful? Now cover your eyes with your palms and notice what you see. Do you see complete darkness? Or do you notice patterns of light, colors, or shapes floating about? You must know that these things, they are not really there. They are just irritations on your optic nerve, phantoms which haunt your mind's eye. So now we begin the exercise number two, palming. A meditation to make the mind see complete darkness. Imagine you are in a forest. Lightly drum your fingers on your head. Oh, is it rain? As the big black raindrops fall down from the little black cloud, they color everything to black. The leaves and the branches on the trees become black. The roots and the ground become black. And as the rain subsides, you rest your fingers on your forehead, and all you see is nothing. Take a deep breath and enjoy the dark nothingness of the black forest. But wait! In the middle of the black forest, there is a great, big, black cake. Mmm, a black forest cake.
Cake out of the rain. And on this big black cake, there are five big black candles, each one burning with a big black flame. Go ahead and reach one hand out, and with eyes still closed, feel the heat from those big black candles. Now we are going to blow them out one by one, and as we do, fold just one finger into your hand. So take a deep breath and blow out the thumb. Breathe in and index finger. Again and middle finger. Once more and ring finger until all that is left is your pinky finger. Now open your eyes and look at your finger for exercise number three, blinking to train the focus. Gaze at your pinky and blink. Now pick a point across the room. Did you find one? Good. Now blink and look again at your pinky. Blink to look at your point. Every time you blink, you switch the focus. Blink to pinky, blink to point. Blink to pinky, blink to point. Now blink to a person. Anybody will do. Now blink, pinky, blink, point, blink, person. Blink, pinky, blink, point, blink, person. And blink to the shape on top of your head. Faster now. Blink, pinky, blink, point, blink, person, blink, shape. Remember to breathe. Blink, blink, pinky, point, blink, blink, person, shape. Pinky, point, person, shape. Pinky, point, person, shape. Pinky, point, person, shape. And blink, 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 and blink, and blink, and blink, blink, blink. Now look inside your own mind. And breathe and relax. This concludes cassette number one of tonight. There are 234 cassettes in the series. To order the next one, along with a refill of Count Macula's magic potion, send a check or money order for $59.95 to the address on the package. Please allow 4 to 6 weeks for delivery. Until then, remember, your eyes have ears.
This is baloney.
No, hey, listen to me. If you tell yourself that you cannot see, then that will be true. What it is that clouds your vision may be less your eyes and more your own mind. This way of thinking and worrying about what others will think. Do not let these things cast their shadow over you. Why do you hide your eyes from the world, and the world from your eyes? You are not a vampire. You are a human being. Why not live like one?
This is my mom. She was 4 feet 10 and a half inches tall. Now I think she's about 4'10¼" tall. She doesn't really tower over me anymore. She still has this curly red hair, but I think she dyes it now. And that's my dad. He still dresses like Simon and Garfunkel. I'm not sure which one. He wears those dark turtlenecks and these dark sunglasses. Sometimes he has to wear them inside. And outside, sometimes he has to wear two pairs, one on top of the other. And that's me. And I'm a lot of both of these people. You know, somewhere between sighted and not sighted. Somewhere between able-bodied and disabled. And that spectrum of ability and disability is a lot to explain to people, even people that I know, even my closest friends, let alone strangers, let alone first dates, potential employers, institutions of higher learning, government sorcerers or vampires. To make all this more palatable, what I think I should do is just have a party, like a coming out party. You know, with ice cream and party hats and everything. And music, yeah. I still have this guitar, and I still remember the chords that my dad taught me when I was 4, 5, or 6 years old. I think. To thank Monica Wiles, who was our production assistant. She made the blindfold and painted the cloud black, among other things. Danny Solomon was the house manager tonight. She folded the programs, punched those little holes and did all that whole stuff. And we have our filming crew of Bettina and Alex and Michael, who are super nice to be doing this. They offered and I was like, yes, let's do it. And then of course the folks from Little Baby's Ice Cream who are here. So what we're going to do is we're going to have a talk back as soon as we get the stage a little bit tidier. And I'd like to do the ice cream in rows, like the first row could go and get ice cream first and then come back. And then the second row, you know, and so that can not swamp the guy from Little Babies. I mean, they are just little babies. And yeah, then we'll start the talk back really, really soon. Just as soon as the first row comes back and is back in their chairs. We'll do that. I'd also like to thank the folks from the Rotunda, especially Jason, who's here tonight, and Gina and Frank, and all of you for coming. So come back for the talk back. I'm really looking forward to this.
Whoa, thank you.